I've worked as a nurse for over 5 years, and in that time, I thought I had seen it all. I'd handled all kinds of situations, from life-threatening emergencies to simple flu checkups. But sometimes, something happens that reminds me I haven't quite seen everything. And this day, well, this day was different. It was the kind of day that sticks with you, the kind that makes you question how well you really know your patients. My name is Lisa, and I work at a small but busy clinic in the heart of the city. The clinic isn't big or fancy, but we handle a wide range of patients from all walks of life, young, old, rich, poor, you name it. I've always loved my job, mostly because I get to help people in their time of need. But as much as I love it, some days are just strange. It was a typical Monday morning, which meant the clinic was already packed by the time I arrived. Mondays were always chaotic. People would put off seeing the doctor all weekend, thinking they'd get better on their own, only to realize they needed help first thing on Monday. By the time I clocked in at 8 a.m., the waiting room was buzzing with patients, all eager to be seen. I flipped through the day's appointment list and quickly scanned the names. Most of the patients were regulars, people I'd treated several times before. There was Mrs. Johnson, who came in for her blood pressure checkups, Mr. Fright Richards with his bad knee, and then there was John Davis. He was on the list for a routine follow-up for his diabetes. John was one of those patients you saw regularly, but didn't know much about personally. He came in every few months to monitor his condition, and we always exchanged polite small talk. John was in his mid-40s, average height, a little overweight, with thinning hair and a calm demeanor. He was the kind of patient who never caused trouble, always polite and respectful. At 9 a.m., I called his name from the waiting room. "John Davis," I said, and he got up from his chair with a small smile. "Good morning, Lisa," he greeted me as he walked towards the examination room. His voice was friendly, and there was nothing out of the ordinary about him that day. "Morning, John," I replied, leading him into the room. "How are you feeling today?" He shrugged, looking a little tired, but otherwise fine. "Oh, you know, the usual. Blood sugar's been a little high lately, but I'm managing." I nodded as I motioned for him to take a seat on the examination table. "Well, let's check everything out and see how you're doing." Everything started off just as it always did. I checked his blood pressure first, slightly elevated, but nothing alarming. His pulse was normal, and his temperature was fine. We chatted a bit about his weekend. He mentioned that he'd been busy with some home repairs and had spent the Sunday watching football. Nothing unusual, nothing that hinted at what was to come. Then, as I prepared to check his blood sugar, I noticed something subtle. As John rolled up his sleeve for me to prick his finger, he seemed hesitant. His hand brushed against his pants in a way that made him tense up. His body language shifted, and he suddenly seemed a little more uncomfortable. I didn't think much of it at first. Patients sometimes got nervous during their checkups, especially when it came to needles or blood tests. I figured it was just one of those moments. I pricked his finger and took the blood sample. "Your sugar's running a little high today," I said, noting the results in his chart. "Have you been following your diet like we talked about?" John hesitated before answering. "Yeah, mostly," he said, but his eyes shifted downward and he avoided looking directly at me. That's when I noticed his discomfort growing. His hand moved again towards his lap, this time more deliberately, and he seemed to be hiding something. His face turned slightly red, and I could tell that whatever was going on, it was more than just nerves about the checkup. Before I could ask him what was wrong, John blurted out something I wasn't expecting. "Lisa, there's something I need to tell you," he said, his voice shaky. I stopped what I was doing and looked at him. "What is it, John?" I asked, my tone concerned but calm. I had no idea what he was about to say, but something told me it was serious. He took a deep breath and glanced down at his lap again. "There's something in my pants," he said, almost in a whisper. At first, I didn't understand what he meant. "Excuse me?" I asked, thinking I had misheard him. "Something in your pants?" John nodded, his face now bright red with embarrassment. "Yeah, it's not normal," he said, his words barely audible. My mind raced as I tried to process what he was saying. What could he possibly mean? Was it a medical issue? Was he in pain? I had no idea, but I could tell he was deeply uncomfortable. I took a deep breath, reminding myself that I was a professional. John, it's okay. You can tell me anything. I'm here to help. What's going on? I asked, keeping my voice calm and reassuring. John hesitated for a moment before reaching down and unzipping his pants slightly. My heart started racing, not because of anything inappropriate, but because I could sense how distressed he was. He wasn't trying to be rude or inappropriate. He was genuinely scared. As John revealed what was in his pants, I was momentarily stunned. There in front of me was a large bulge, a swelling that looked abnormal. My mind tried to make sense of it. At first, I thought it might be a hernia, but it was larger than I had expected. This wasn't something small or easy to ignore. John's face was filled with shame and embarrassment. "I've had this swelling for a while now," he confessed, his voice trembling. "I thought it would go away on its own, but it's just gotten bigger." Suddenly, everything made sense. John wasn't being inappropriate. He wasn't trying to cross any lines. He was terrified, and he didn't know how to ask for help. My initial shock faded, and I quickly switched into professional mode. "John, why didn't you say anything sooner?" I asked gently, trying to make him feel more comfortable. He sighed heavily. "I was embarrassed. I didn't know how to bring it up. I thought maybe it wasn't serious, but now I'm really scared." I could see the fear in his eyes. This wasn't just about the physical issue. John had been carrying the emotional burden of this problem for a long time, and now it was too much for him to handle alone. I put on my gloves and gently examined the swelling. It was large, but there were no signs of infection or immediate danger. Still, it was clearly a serious issue that needed attention. "John, this looks like it could be a hernia or possibly something else that needs treatment," I explained, keeping my tone calm. "It's important that you see a doctor about this right away." John nodded, still looking worried. "Do you think it's serious?" he asked, his voice barely above a whisper. "I don't know for sure," I replied honestly, "but it's definitely not something you should ignore. The sooner you get it checked out, the better." I could see the relief starting to wash over him, but there was still a lingering embarrassment in his expression. "Thank you for not making me feel, you know, weird about it," he said softly. "I didn't know how to talk about it." I smiled at him, trying to put him at ease. "John, you don't have to be embarrassed. We all have things that happen to our bodies that we don't expect. What's important is that you took the step to talk about it. That's what matters." He nodded again, this time with a bit more confidence. "Do you think I should make an appointment with a specialist?"
"Yes, definitely," I replied. "I can help you set up the appointment if you'd like."
John looked at me with gratitude in his eyes. "I'd really appreciate that, Lisa. Thank you." After I finished the examination, I walked John to the front desk and helped him schedule an appointment with a specialist. As we stood there, he looked visibly more relaxed, as if a weight had been lifted off his shoulders. "I can't thank you enough," John said as we finished the paperwork. "I've been carrying this secret for months, and it's been driving me crazy." I smiled at him. "I'm just glad you came forward. Now you can focus on getting better." As John left the clinic, I couldn't help but think about how easy it is for people to keep their problems hidden, even when they're suffering. So many patients like John carry a heavy emotional burden because they are afraid of judgment or embarrassment. And yet, talking about these issues is the first step toward finding a solution. It reminded me of how important it is to create a safe space for patients, a place where they can speak openly without fear. As I returned to the examination room, I couldn't stop thinking about John's situation. It was a simple medical issue, yet it had affected him so deeply, not just physically, but emotionally. I thought about how many others might be suffering in silence, afraid to seek help because of embarrassment. Working as a nurse, I've learned that people often feel vulnerable when it comes to their bodies. We live in a world where we're expected to be perfect, and any sign of weakness or imperfection is seen as a flaw. John's case wasn't about just a medical condition. It was about the emotional toll that hiding something for so long had taken on him. Later that day, I shared the experience with one of the doctors, not in a gossipy way, but as a means of understanding. Dr. Evans, one of the senior doctors in the clinic, nodded as I described the situation. "It's more common than you think," she said. "Patients, especially men,
often hesitate to talk about anything involving their private areas. The stigma and embarrassment can keep them from getting the help they need. Her words stayed with me for the rest of the day. How many people had I seen who were hiding something because they were too afraid or embarrassed to talk about it? It made me realize how important my role was, not just in treating physical ailments, but in helping patients feel comfortable enough to open up about their problems. A week later, John returned to the clinic for a follow-up. This time, he seemed more at ease, a stark contrast to the nervous and embarrassed man I had seen the previous week. He had visited the specialist as we had discussed, and the news, while not great, wasn't as bad as he had feared. "It was a hernia," he explained when I asked him how it went. "The doctor said I'll need surgery, but it's nothing too serious. He said I should have come in sooner, though." I smiled at him. "The important thing is that you're getting it treated now. You've taken the right steps." John nodded, looking relieved. "I feel so much better now that I know what it is. Honestly, Lisa, I don't know why I waited so long. I guess I was just too embarrassed." "It's normal to feel that way," I reassured him. "But now you know that it's okay to speak up about these things. Your health is more important than anything else." John thanked me again before he left, and I couldn't help but feel a sense of satisfaction. Helping people wasn't always about curing them or giving them medicine. Sometimes it was about listening, understanding, and guiding them through difficult moments. In John's case, the simple act of talking about his problem had made all the difference. That experience with John left a lasting impression on me. It taught me that sometimes the hardest part of dealing with a health problem isn't the problem itself. It's the fear of talking about it. Whether it's because of embarrassment, shame, or fear of judgment, many people suffer in silence, waiting for the issue to go away on its own. But as I saw with John, that's not always the best course of action. Problems don't just disappear, and ignoring them can often make things worse. As healthcare workers, we have a responsibility to create an environment where patients feel safe to talk about their concerns, no matter how awkward or uncomfortable they may be. It's not just about treating illnesses. It's about treating people with kindness, respect, and understanding. I want to share this message with anyone who might be watching or reading this story. Don't be afraid to speak up about your health. It doesn't matter how embarrassing or awkward it might seem. Your health is important, and nothing is too small or too personal to discuss with a healthcare professional. The sooner you address an issue, the sooner you can start getting better. John's story is a reminder to all of us. If something doesn't feel right, don't wait. Don't let embarrassment or fear keep you from seeking help. There's no shame in asking for assistance, and there's no problem too small to bring to your doctor or nurse. At the end of the day, this story isn't just about a man with a hernia. It's about the importance of communication, trust, and taking control of your health. If you're ever in a situation where you feel too embarrassed or scared to talk about something with your healthcare provider, remember John's story. He waited too long to speak up, and while his issue was treatable, it could have been resolved much sooner if he had felt comfortable talking about it. We all deserve to live healthy, happy lives, but that can only happen if we take the first step, speaking up when something doesn't feel right. Thank you for watching or reading this story on Honest Confession. If you've ever found yourself in a similar situation, too afraid or embarrassed to talk about something, share your story in the comments below. Let's build a community where we can support each other and learn from our experiences. If this story resonated with you, don't forget to like the video and subscribe to Honest Confession for more real-life stories that touch on some of life's most difficult moments. We have many more honest, dramatic stories coming your way, so make sure to hit the notification bell so you never miss an update. Remember, it's okay to speak up, it's okay to ask for help, your health and well-being are worth it. Stay honest, stay strong, and take care of yourself. Till I see you again in my next story, goodbye.